Tonight, I want to touch on the journey that I've been on for the last maybe 25, 30 years, and to give you an understanding as to why I was called to Australia. So I'm going to put on the pastor's hat now and share from that direction so I understand my heart, because I'm sure you'll understand the journey. I'm from the country of Sri Lanka originally. People ask me, when Sri Lanka and Australia play cricket, who do I support? I said, I'm a winner either way. You got to be wise how you answer those questions. A nation which was wrecked by terrorism. Thankfully, things have changed now. My first encounter ever was in 1976 as a 12-year-old boy. I was forced to go to a church down the street with my mother and my father. There was an Aussie preacher there. In my mind, I'd worked it out. Church was not for young people. Church was for people who are about to kick the bucket. Church got to be a boring place, because I used to see people in my community on Sunday. They used to put on the church mask. They'd tuck their Bible under their arms and they'd walk like this. They're very holy, you know. So I asked one guy, I said, excuse me, uncle. We sort of address people who are a bit older. Uncle, why are you so sad when you go to church? He said, no, son, I have deep joy. His joy was so deep, I had to hire a scuba diver to pull it out. So my parents forced me to go to church. There was a preacher from Australia who was speaking at that church. And suddenly he stopped speaking. And he looked towards me, and I looked the other side. And something called a prophetic word, at that point I had no understanding what that was. He said, you young man, God has a plan for you. So I pretended I didn't hear. He said, I'm talking to you. I still pretended I didn't hear. So people around me were tapping me and telling me he's talking to you. I said, just shut up. I was very new to that church. Then he said, you with the green t-shirt, I'm talking to you. So I turned around and looked at him, by which time he was right next to me. And then he said this long story about how I was going to go and speak to the nations and governments, and nations will come back to God. And I'm thinking, this time you made a big mistake. Because I had determined in my heart, I'm not going to follow Jesus, because this is all rubbish. That's what I thought. Anyway, what seemed to be a long, boring message he gave me, which I didn't realize was a prophetic word, finished and he walked away. Suddenly I heard screaming right after that. So I turned around and I looked, and there was this man with long hair, possessed with demons, creating an absolute panic in the place. Some people were holding him. They dragged him and they locked him in a room. Now, that room had high walls. In between the roof and the ceiling, there was the roof and the rafters. Well, there was this rafter like about that high. Suddenly this bloke appears on the rafter. Now, I was shocked because I'd never seen anything like this. And the guy does something like, I didn't know what that was. And the pastor from Australia looks at him and very gently he says, in Jesus' name, down. And I said, what are you talking? Why are you telling that fellow to come down? If he jumps, he's going to break his legs. The guy just jumped from there, flat on the ground. Nothing happened. The next thing I see is he's moving like a snake. And guess where he was coming? He had some company. He was coming towards me. I saw him coming and I absolutely freaked out. I jumped over three seats and I ran out of the church. So my first time in church was very interesting. I'd like to share this little story, which a true story which happened in America. There was a church service. And everyone was very excited. And the pastor said, let's close the service by singing that song. In the name of Jesus, we have the victory. Demons will have to flee.
Yes.
Heard of that song? Okay. Now, when they were singing, in that same suburb, there was a fun fair. And people were used to dressing up in different costumes and going for this fun fair. One young boy living down the street decided to dress like a devil. So he put on a skeleton on and he put this false hair, blood, pretend blood flowing through his sights and all that. Looked really scary. He's walking towards the fun fair. Now suddenly it started pouring with rain. Now his clothes are getting wet. Suddenly there was lightning and the electricity failed. Now the church congregation has lit up some candles and the pastor said, let your light shine. So they're singing in the name of Jesus. Demons will have to flee. And the pastor said, walk out of the building singing in the name of Jesus, demons will have to flee. So they're sort of turning around and they're starting to walk, coming out of the church. The boy's clothes were getting wet. He had no place to go. Streaks of lightning, no electricity. The boy runs up the steps towards the church. As he approached the church and he starts coming up the steps, the people are coming out of the church and they were singing. Demons will have to. Pastor, there's a demon coming up! They turned around and they ran into the church. The boy didn't know what was happening. He got so scared, he ran around after them. They ran out of the back door and they came through the garden and the demon was following them. I said there are a lot of NATO Christians. No action, talk only. So that was my first encounter. Anyway, to cut a long story short, some years later in 1983, I was playing in a nightclub. I'm a drummer. I'd grown my hair long and I wore earrings and I had holy trousers without prayer. And I was invited to go on a youth camp by my lead guitarist who had said, I've just come to Jesus, I can't play in the nightclub anymore. So I don't want to tell you all the reasons why I went to the youth camp, but I didn't go to meet Jesus at the youth camp. I went there with Ed because there were a lot of girls going there. At that time I was much younger, so you know what I mean. Anyway, at the youth camp something happened to me. The last day of the camp, I surrendered my life to Jesus. Great change since I was born. Great change since I was born. Great change since I was born. There's a great change since I was born. Things I used to do, I do them no more. Books I used to read, I read them no more. Places I went, I go there no more. There's a great change since I was born. Praise God. That day, my friend told me that I was for 40 minutes weeping on my knees. Now, I didn't have the full understanding of everything. Started life in church. My pastor gave me the first job was to mow the lawn in the church. For 2 years, that's what I did. He told me to come. I said, what can I do to serve God? He said, come on Saturday morning. I thought I was going to be on the worship team. Because I'm a drummer, I'm a singer. But instead, he had the lawnmower. So for 2 years, I mowed the lawn. I did it unto the Lord, as I did it unto the, helped the church, but I was doing it unto the master. Anyway, this journey continued, and 1983, we encountered a major challenge. There was ethnic cleansing in Sri Lanka. A lot of my community were badly affected. Houses were burned down and my parents were almost killed. I was 3 months a Christian then. Some 20 men were at my door. I was not at home and I just come and I saw them at the door trying to pull my parents out of the house to burn them alive. And I prayed to God without knowing how to pray. I said, hey you God, what do you think you're doing up there? If you don't come down and save them, you're not God. I will not believe you anymore. I'm going to go to the north of Sri Lanka, train with the Tamil Tigers, come and kill all these fellows here. because I know half of them. At that moment, a woman who was not a Christian, who lived behind my home, came out screaming and shouting because my parents had looked after her when she was in trouble. She stood in the gap in between the mob and my parents, and she screamed at the group. She said, "Get out. Don't touch that family. They are better than our community," she told them. "If you want to kill them, you have to kill me and walk over my dead body." At this, the whole group turned and walked away. Now, the younger brother of that woman was the gang leader. So he had to kill his sister to kill my parents. At that point, I said, "God, I know that you're real." 87, I got married. 1989, we had our son. 91, we had our daughter. And then after 15 years, we had our third child in 2007. I followed the advice of Peter Costello. He said, "Have one for the mother, one for the father, one for the country." Actually, I told him that. On the 22nd, he called me. He said, "Pastor Daniel, congratulations. I heard your wife gave birth." I said, "Yeah, thanks for the advice." Yeah. So in 1995, we moved to Saudi Arabia. I didn't want to go there. Christian worship is a criminal offense, but the Lord took me there. I won't go through all the details. Now, one of my amazing happenings in Saudi Arabia was when my house was raided. I said that I'll share this on this journey. You can't practice Christianity there. It's a major offense. So we had to work undercover. An American guy called me who I knew that he was working for the CIA. He said, "Can we meet for coffee?" We met for coffee. At the coffee, he said to me, "I can get you 1,800 Bibles in 13 languages once in 3 weeks. Would you like to have them?" I said, "Yes." "But there's no Bibles there." He said, "What passport do you have?" I said, "Sri Lankan." He said, "Better not take this challenge." I said, "Why?" He said, "With a Sri Lankan passport, if you get caught, because it's a third world country, they'll execute you." "Is your wife here?" I said, "Yes, they'll rape her and kill her." "Your children?" "Yes, they'll take them into an Islamic orphanage." "I'm telling you, don't do it." I said, "But people need the Bible." He said, "Yeah. But if you get caught, you're in big trouble." I said, "Let me go and pray." So I went home and started fasting and praying and asking God for some direction. And I had this clear word come to me: 1,000 on your side and 10,000 on your right shall fall. Nothing shall touch you. Bring my word and feed my flock. So I told him, "Bring it. I'll look, take care of it." So the Bible started coming. Everything was going well. Until one day, I heard this dreaded knock on my door. If you hear that knock, you know your house has been raided by the Secret Service. I ran to the front door, looked through the spy hole. There were 20 soldiers from the Saudi Secret Service, armed with 8 machine guns, standing at my door. All the guns were pointing at my door. And at once I remembered, 400 Bibles are sitting on my lounge room table. Open the door, 2 steps into the house, they'll see the Bibles. That's it. You know, my whole world was, I thought at that moment, it's gone. Fear absolutely gripped my heart. I was horrified to think that my wife is going to be raped and killed. I was just absolutely breaking up into 1,000 pieces, thinking, I'll never see my children again until I meet them in heaven one day. I didn't quite worry about myself, what was going to happen, but I was thinking of myself. You can't dial 000, 999, there's no support there. So I had to dial the heaven's channel. So how did I do it? I fell behind the doorway. I couldn't talk loud because it's too dangerous. This guy is banging the door. I cried out from the bottom of my heart, "Where are you? God, where are you? I'm about to be destroyed. Where are you?" Second or third time when I said, "Where are you?" I heard these words clearly. "Haven't I told you, 1,000 on your side and 10,000 on your right shall fall. Nothing shall touch you. My blood is on your doorpost. No one who is not authorized can enter your home. Open the door, stand in my name and cast these demons out." That just, I don't know, it's like someone gave me this power boost. I just jumped off the floor because I have cast out a lot of evil spirits out of people. A lot of demons out of deacons. No, I mean, sorry, what did I say? Yes. But my minister, my pastor used to call me Triple D. Triple D stood for Demon Delivering Danny. I used to stop my car and chase people down the street because I know they're demon possessed. Yeah, and I get them and cast them out. It's happened so many times, even in Australia. Believe me, in Australia it's happened so many times. So when I realized this battle was not flesh and blood, but principalities and powers of darkness, I was ready for the challenge. I ran into my bedroom. My wife and two children were up now, hugging each other, and they were in tears. When I looked at them, one side of me says, God will come through. Another side of me says, what if he does not? We are human, right? And I was breaking up, but I put on a very strong face and I told my wife, it's all right. Just pray. I hugged them and kissed them because I was sort of saying goodbye if I don't see you. I don't know whether you'll understand this, but in Saudi Arabia, when this is happening, it's horrible. I ran to the door and I said, God, into your hands I commit my family and my life. And I opened the door. When I opened the door, the soldier is standing, 6 foot guy with his whole Saudi gear. And I looked in his eyes. He was looking in my eyes. For 30 seconds, there was not one word spoken. I want you to understand, 30 seconds is a very long time when you're facing a eight machine guns. 60 seconds, no talk. Now I tell you, I had not put up any makeup at that time, so my face was not looking very good. 90 seconds, no talk. At that point, the Holy Spirit whispers in my ear, for I have confused the enemy and he cannot remember why he has come to your house. I wanted to shout hallelujah, but I think the Holy Spirit said something like, shut up. It was tensed. After 2 minutes, the guy goes, Habibi, Ikama! In Arabic, that means, mate, give me your identification. Took it and I gave it to him. He looked at it. He turned around and he looked at his unit. They're all waiting for this guy to say, enter. Unless he says enter, they can't enter. If he says enter, 2 steps, they'll see 400 Bibles on the table. The guy turns around, he looks at me. He turns around and he looks at them. He does this 6 times over and over again, by which time I realize he is possibly quite confused. Then the guy turns around and he says, Shukran Habibi! Thank you, mate. I said, Afran Habibi! Don't mention mate, put it in my pocket. Then the guy looked at me. Habibi! Yeah! He told the whole unit, mate, go. Not one person entered my house. I shut the door. I get goosebumps when I share it every time because I feel the time what happened. I shut the door when the 20th man left and I fell on my knees and I shouted, as long as I have breath, I will serve you. Can we give my Jesus another clap, please? So then the journey continued. I used to baptize people in the Red Sea. Awesome. I baptized people in the Jordan River and the Red Sea. But both never parted when I walked in the water. The Red Sea, we used to baptize 40, 50 new converts once in 6 months. We used to go through the desert, 40 kilometers away from any civilization, taking them into the water. Now, if you get caught baptizing converts to Christianity, you're gone in Saudi Arabia. No way will you live after that. But we used to we had a plan. I saw 2 guys on the shore watching both sides. The Coast Guard comes on a 4-wheel drive with machine guns to make sure that the coast is protected. I take the 40, 50 people who I want to baptize into the water. The good thing is the Red Sea up to the reef, you can walk. The water is up to your waist. I'm a good swimmer when my feet strikes the ground. So I take them right down there and I tell my 2 guys, watch out. If you see the jeep coming, they will go like this. They whistle. As they whistle, I drop the person I'm baptizing. We all start swimming. Some guys have put up the barbecues. They're cooking a barbecue. Some guys are kicking a soccer ball. So it's like a group of people that come on a picnic. So the commandos jump off the jeep. They look at us. They're just swimming, having a barbecue. Nothing wrong. They get in the jeep. As they go away, another whistle comes. As it comes, I go, hallelujah, in Jesus' name. Get them baptized. So it was fun. But today, if you tell me you'll give me $10 million, will you go back to Saudi Arabia? No. It's not my time right now. That was my time. And so I was serving God there underground with the church. I went with a job, of course, to Saudi Arabia, but I did not realize why I was there until I walked into Australia. I was there because God had a plan for Australia and the West, that I would come out and be a voice to tell the people, if you don't wake up to the spirit of Islam and fight it with everything you have, you'll lose your land. Remember, I didn't say fight Muslims. I said fight Islam, the spirit. We don't fight people. We fight the spirits. So Islam's teachings are horrible. They're demonic. There are a lot of good Muslim people which we need to love and care for them. But if they are indoctrinated by their teachings, they are dangerous. So in Saudi Arabia, God gave me the opportunity to bring together 500 church leaders 40 minutes from Mecca on 18 July 1997 to worship Him. For 5 hours we worshiped the Lord. This is in Saudi Arabia. At that time there was 500 churches underground. Could be 1,000 now. Thousands of Saudis are coming to Jesus. All through the Middle East, tens of thousands of Muslims are turning to Jesus. Yes. Awesome. I can tell you testimony after testimony after testimony of how Muslims are coming to the Lord. But on 21st July 1997, it was just another day, we all went to sleep. When my telephone started ringing, I ran to the telephone to pick it up. There was no one on the phone. It was in my lounge room. The lights were all switched off. There was some street light just giving a bit of light into the lounge room. I thought, who on earth is calling me and hanging up? I looked at the time, it was 3:40 in the morning. I put my phone back on the receiver and I turned back to go to sleep. When my whole lounge room just lit up as if though someone put 3 to 5 fluorescent bulbs on. Now I'm standing here at the corner of the lounge room. I know that there is someone who has just come into my house. A figure of a man, glowing with shining light. Hands seemed to be stretched out like that. And it was like a radiant light. My whole body started trembling and shaking, because I knew I was going to be having a meeting with Jesus or one of His angels. So I couldn't walk, because if you know in worship, the presence of God comes and it's so amazing. But when you're standing possibly in front of Jesus or an angel, the presence is awesome. I fell on my knees. I grabbed the Bible in my hand. And I'm bent into shaking like crazy when I hear footsteps walking towards me. And then the words came, my son, I want to talk to you. At that moment I realized an angel cannot call me my son, that I was meeting with Jesus. That day was the best day in my life. For 2 hours and 20 minutes, Jesus stood right in front of me. And He spoke to me with His audible voice. I couldn't see His face. His light was shining bright. But He stood in front of me, and this was the first words He said to me. Your time in Saudi Arabia is over. I'm about to do a work in Australia. I'm taking you to that land. I said, but God, 3 days ago 500 people came together. How can I leave Saudi Arabia? You know what He told me? He said, who is doing the work in this land? I said, you, Lord. He said, my work will continue. Go. Then He told me that I was going to speak in the U.S. Congress, in the White House, National Security Council, U.S. State Department, British Parliament, Australian Parliament. And I will be a voice for the voiceless persecuted Christians passing legislation in the US Congress. And I'm thinking, what are you telling me, Jesus? This is what I was thinking. How can I do that? Don't you understand my skin color is black? I had such low self-esteem, I thought I can never ever speak to a Western audience. And I'm thinking, how will they ever listen to what I'm going to say? I didn't even know what was Capitol Hills. I didn't know what the National Security Council was. I didn't know what the US State Department was. I've heard about the Congress. White House, I thought it was a White House. And I said, all these reasons, I just stacked it up and told Jesus why I can't do it. He told me in response, in his audible voice, I'm not after your ability, I'm only after your availability. I said, okay. He said, now you will leave this country. You will live by faith. I am going to provide what you need. Now I'm thinking immediately in my mind, I was getting a fantastic salary in Saudi Arabia. No tax. If I go to Australia, what am I going to do? Where am I going to get the money from? But guess what? What I am thinking, he already knew. Duh, I should have thought a bit better. Jesus responds, as I think, he says to me, I am Jehovah Jireh. I am the Lord that provides. I said, yes, Lord. I won't go into the rest of the encounter, but I didn't know what time it was, 2 hours and 20 minutes, I realized it was just before he left. His hands came out of the glow and he put it on my head. And he said, I'm anointing you for the task ahead of you. I saw his hands and the hands were like, I don't know how to explain it, it's like eternity. And then he left. I looked at the clock, 6 o'clock. 2 hours and 20 minutes seemed like 2 minutes. It just went, just like that. Said, okay, now I had no clue what I was going to do. The morning I woke my wife up and I told her, we're leaving Saudi Arabia. Within 3 months, believe me, within 3 months, I've already spoken. I had met in the Congress, God opened doors for me to go and address the Congress, White House, National Security Council, State Department, British Parliament, House of Lords and House of Commons. In 3 months, from a place of having no clue, no understanding, having understood. You know what is amazing is I'm sitting in front of these congressional select committees to give them a briefing on religious freedom issues and how Christians and other groups are persecuted. Now they're all seated around me and I'm thinking, what am I going to exactly tell them? And the Bible says, do not worry what you're going to speak, for I'll fill your mouth with words when you're in front of governors and rulers. And these words come and I'm just speaking and I'm speaking and my mind is going, wow, that's very impressive what I'm saying. Because these guys are taking notes. I hope they don't ask me a second time. For 1 year I worked in the Congress very closely. And in 1998, I was successful in passing a legislation called the Freedom from Religious Persecution Act 1998. You know, who was the answer to that? House of Reps said, no, we can't put it through. I challenged them and it opened up a doorway. It got through the House of Reps. It went to the Senate and they took it to Clinton's administration to check whether they'll pass it, whether Clinton will sign it. And Bill Clinton said he will not sign it because his relationship with the royal family will be destroyed if he signed this bill. They brought it back. They asked me, can I change it? I said, no, it has to go the way it is. So I went through CBN. Pat Robertson is a good friend of mine. And he gave me a lot of footage, coverage on CBN and many other news channels. And we got the Chris Americans praying. You know what our prayer answer to prayer was? Monica Lewinsky. You remember that name? Suddenly, Monica Lewinsky's case got exposed. As it got exposed, Clinton, who was riding so high, just fell right down. His ego was smashed. And he basically was fighting for survival. Now, in the Congress, there's a group called the Christian Mafia. These are Christian congressmen who fight for Christian rights. They were the ones who were going to impeach Bill Clinton, putting an impeachment motion. To butter them up, he said, bring that bill, I'll sign it for you. 18 July 1998, the bill went through the Congress and it got passed. Praise God. So now, year 2000, 3 years I'm in Australia. Australia was very boring because there was no action. The demons were so distinguished. Nothing was happening. No healings, no miracles, no action. I was really bored. So I used to travel and do massive meetings like in Indonesia, all the African countries, and tens of thousands of people were coming. I would land in Melbourne and I was like, when am I going out again? Like, you know, I want to see action. And year 2000, I was speaking in Ethiopia, in a city called Wendogenet. And I had a dream. In the dream, I'm sharing this with a purpose. So as I come to the end, you'll understand why I'm sharing all of this too, for you to have faith in what God is doing for Australia. Australia has tremendous hope. I'm telling you, Australia has destiny. Yes. Islam will never be successful in Australia. So what happens? I'm here, spoken to 20,000 people the night before, went to sleep, 5 o'clock in the morning, had a dream. In the dream, there was a street and there were many houses. One house, the garden was very badly neglected. Anyone with a messed up garden, put your hands up. No. 3 houses down the street, there was a beautiful garden, green lush grass, apples on the tree, the guy was watering the plants. A man walked out of the messed up garden, walked into the beautiful garden, broke an apple and started eating. In the dream, I asked God, what does that mean? And he answered me in the dream. He said, when your backyard is in a mess, why are you running all over the world to win the lost? I couldn't understand. I said, what do you mean, Lord? He said, son, Ethiopia is a poor country, but they are very rich in me. 60,000 Ethiopians were turning to Jesus every month at that time. When I asked the pastor, how did this happen? How did this revival come into Ethiopia? He opened his mouth and told me to look in his mouth. And I said, what does that mean? He said, just look in my mouth. He had no teeth. I asked him, what does that have to do with revival? He said, until the communist regimes ruled this country till 1991, they told us to deny Jesus. When we refused to deny Jesus, they would put a piece of iron rod in our mouth, lock our jaws open, loose the plier to pull teeth out as punishment. He said, we paid the price. And then the Lord said, your country is spiritually bankrupt, Australia, but it's materially rich. Now, when your backyard is in a mess, why are you trying to win the lost in another backyard? You're eating of the fruits of another man's labor. Go and call my people to repent and pray. I said, Lord, for how long? He said, give me 20 years, I'll give you the nation. That was in year 2000. 15 years gone by, 5 years more. Love it. I said, Lord, but it's going to be so boring. I honestly said this. This was all an interaction in the dream, right? And Jesus responds in the dream. Whose work are you going to do? What you think is good for me? Or what I know what is right for my kingdom? I said, Lord, whatever you tell me to do, I will do. So here, 2000, I come back, and the Lord gave me a blueprint of what to do. He said, start a prayer movement and call it Rise Up Australia, a call to prayer and repentance. As in 2 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who are called by name, you know, humble themselves and pray, turn away from their wicked ways, I'll hear from heaven, forgive their sin and heal their land. So today we have approximately 100 prayer groups across the country which pray for Australia. And I would greatly encourage this church, if you can take it on your, as a part of your church program, to pray for Australia under this banner. It will be really great. Because prayer is the key, but prayer also needs people who are going to stand in the gap and act. Just praying only is not going to work. So we started prayer and things were going well, praise God. We had many opposition attacks and so on from people from within the church, but we just kept going. Now, then I started researching about the history of Australia, about the indigenous people. I look a bit like an indigenous person. So I get a lot of inroads into the indigenous community. They love me. They tell me, you're one of our fellas, mate. Yeah. Do you know this? This will interest you. 200 years ago, the British came into Australia. 200 years ago, the British went to Sri Lanka, which was known as Ceylon. Sri Lanka, Ceylon, was occupied by the Portuguese and the British for 150 years each prior to that. The British occupied Sri Lanka for another 150 years, so 450 years of foreign occupation. The biggest mistake which took place in Sri Lanka was the British leaving. They should have stayed. Sri Lanka would be a first world country today. We regret them leaving. My grandparents, who were Hindu, came to Christ because of the Brits coming there. But the Brits found out that there were many Sri Lankan road construction engineers who were very good in their construction of roads. Portuguese had trained them. So they brought shiploads of workers to work on the roads in Australia when they came into Australia. Have you heard of the place called Gandagai? Yes. It's a Sri Lankan word. Gandagai is bad smell in Sri Lanka. It was supposed to be a garbage dump. And so the Sri Lankans used to call bad smell Gandagai, Gandagai. And it became Gandagai. Then the other place called Badagini. Have you heard of the place called Badagini? That's another town called Badagini. That means hungry in Sri Lanka. The construction guys were working, their food supplies used to get late in that particular patch of land. So they used to call it, they say we are very hungry. Sri Lankan men intermarried between the indigenous women, because there were not many British women at that point in Australia. And when I went to the indigenous community, they come up to me and they say, hi, how are you? You're from Sri Lanka, I was told. I said, yes. My surname is Fernando. My surname is Pereira. My surname is Silva. And I'm saying, they are Sri Lankan surnames. How come? My great-grandparents were from Sri Lanka. And I thought, wow, isn't it God's plan, something happening? So I'm able to speak into indigenous communities. I've been into Alice Springs, Palm Island, Back of Burke, Yarraba, Darwin, and have had amazing reconciliation with them. Amazing reconciliation. On one side, I'm able to speak about the British coming, why it happened, and let me tell you, this is what the Lord showed me. Your forefathers who left Britain were chosen by God to come out of Britain. They were classed as convicts, but most of them were not real hardcore convicts. They were all petty crimes that they committed because of the recession in Great Britain. They were desperate to keep the food on the table. So mothers worked as prostitutes, fathers robbed a pint of milk or a loaf of bread, got arrested, thrown in the jail, they got so many people were in prison, there was no room, put them on ships and send them to this desert island, what they thought. Now when they came, some bad things happened with the indigenous people, we can't deny that. But the good news is, they brought the word of God into Australia. So when I speak to the indigenous brothers and sisters, I tell them, I know injustice was done, but you guys are very spiritual. You were seeking God, but you didn't have God. These guys brought God to you. So rather than saying you need to say sorry to him, say thank you to them. And as I say this, just something breaks open. I'm at political party meetings, and I talk about reconciliation. And the next thing you see, photographs of footage, we have videos of black and white hugging each other and weeping on each other's shoulders, asking forgiveness. That's true reconciliation. Not just a sorry for the sake of saying sorry, a heartfelt repentance of what has happened. Yeah. So the Brits came here in the thousands. Believe me, the rejects of 200 years ago have become the cornerstone of a great democracy today. The envy of the world. I believe God said something like, you fellows, I'm going to just throw you right down under. Stay there. Because in the end times, I'm going to use you to touch the whole world. I'll tell you why. Smith Wigglesworth prophesied this. I'll come to that in a moment. So anyway, see, East Australia. 400 years ago, Portuguese explorer was sailing on the shores of these islands, stopped in Vanuatu. You all know he called this region the Great Southern Lands of the Holy Spirit. 120 years after him, 280 years ago, Muslim explorers came in a flotilla of boats, were coming to capture Australia. They had taken Indonesia and they were coming to Australia. The records show that they actually saw a massive giant spirit hovering over Australia. They got so scared. They thought that it was an evil spirit, but I believe it's the Holy Spirit. They turned their boats and they went back. They never came back to Australia. God preserved Australia for an hour such as this. Then, I've heard the prophetic word of Smith Wigglesworth over Australia. But I've never met or seen evidence of it. I've never met anyone who could tell me, I know for sure this is what he said because I heard it. Or here's a document, you can read it. How many of you know of the country Smith Wigglesworth visited, which had the highest number of miracles in the shortest number of days? In 3 days, the highest number of miracles took place in one particular country in Smith Wigglesworth's lifetime. Guess, Ceylon, where I actually come from, very close to where I lived, which is interesting. Now, Smith Wigglesworth, how many of you heard of this Smith Wigglesworth? He's a great father of the Christian faith, powerful man. Anyway, so I was wanting to find out what is it, what did he prophesy over Australia? And I was preaching in a church in New South Wales. The pastor of that church is Norm Armstrong, was the pastor of that church. Norm Armstrong, how many of you know Norm Armstrong? Oh, fantastic. Glenda, you were there. You know what I'm talking about. Yeah. So the service went on well. There were 300 people at the church service. And, backtracking a bit. 2002 to 2007, the Muslims took me to court. I thank God that I won the case. When Joseph was thrown in a pit, it was not his brothers, but the Ishmaelite merchants carried him out of the pit and took him into destiny. When I get to heaven, I'm going to ask Joseph a serious question, whether he ever thought of sending Potiphar's wife a thank you card. Had she not falsely accused him, he would have not been in prison to interpret the dreams. Had he not interpreted the dreams, he would have not got the ear of the king. God has a plan in everything which happens in your life. When you have trials and troubles and challenges, don't grumble. Rejoice and say, Lord, what's your plan in this? When you're going through testings, get ready for a great testimony or you can be destroyed. When my court case took place, it was not easy. It was a massive strain. 5 years, it was supposed to be 3 days. It took 5 years, 40 days, full 40 days of hearing. Death threats, firebombing threats, kidnapping threats of my children. Had to raise $600,000 to fight the defense. But it was all worth it because it became a massive testimony. So I thank the Muslims for taking me to court. I will send them a thank you card sometime later. Because they gave me a profile which I did not have. When my own brothers tried to put me in a pit, God raised the Ishmaelites once again to take me to destiny. So I thank the Lord for the Muslim people. I love them. How can I be upset with them when they have given me such an awesome platform to take the word of God through? So 2007, that case finished. And a few months later, I was at Norm Armstrong's church. I was about to preach. Norm Armstrong got up to introduce me. He stopped. And he was like, quiet. And then he said, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. And then he told the church, he said, church, I'm going to share something with you which I have not shared with you ever before. Some of it, he said, you know, some of it you don't know. But you will find out all of it today. He said, my dad was a Salvation Army officer who used to sell insurance policies. One day, an elderly Pentecostal woman got hold of him, prayed over him. He got baptized with the Holy Spirit, prayed in tongues, got kicked out of the Salvation Army. He started a Pentecostal home meeting. It was the first Pentecostal meeting in all of New South Wales, he said. One day I was told by my father, a great preacher is coming to preach in our home. His name is Smith Wigglesworth. I was a young boy of 7 or 9 years old. The house was packed out. People were hanging on the windows and trying to look through. The only place I thought I can watch him preach was if I opened the toilet door and sit on the commode. So Norm said, I sat on the commode and I was watching Smith Wigglesworth preach. When suddenly he stopped and he said, you young fellow in the toilet, come out. And he said, I felt so embarrassed. I walked up to him. I'm standing in front of him. He said, when Smith Wigglesworth came under an anointing. And he said this, and I'll try to repeat what Norm Armstrong said. My son, God has called your nation. Your nation is in God's plan for an end time outpouring and a revival. God has chosen your nation. At the end of the 20th century, into the 21st century, there will be a mighty outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Your nation will carry the John the Baptist anointing. From your nation, nations of the world will be prepared for the second coming of the Lord. The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dumb will speak, the crippled will walk, the dead will rise, demons will be cast out. There will be national reformation in your nation. My son, God has chosen your nation. Now when Norm said that, I was so excited. Because now what I had heard that Smith Wigglesworth had spoken over Australia, I'm hearing it from a man who actually was prophesied over. People were clapping. We were just excited. Norm Armstrong said, now this part I have not shared fully with you, what I'm going to share now. And then Smith Wigglesworth told me, he grabbed hold of me and he said, my son, God shall use a person in your country. This man will be ostracized, but he'll be praying for war. When you see this man, I want you to lay your hands on that man and impart my anointing that I carry from the Lord. Because this man will be used by God to usher in this move of God. My eyes will not see the man. My eyes will not see the move. Your eyes will see the man. You will not see the move. When you see the man, release this anointing into him. Then you shall be caught up with your fathers. So pin drop silence in the whole auditorium. Why is he saying this? Then Norm Armstrong turned around and he looked at me and I went, no way. This can't be me. And Norm Armstrong said, Pastor Daniel, you're that man I've been waiting for 80 plus years. The Lord just confirmed with me after 80 plus years of waiting that he had brought you to Australia, prepared you overseas to fight the battle for this nation. Son, come out. I was sobbing. I was crying. I just could not understand. How am I going to do this? Who am I? Who am I, Lord? I fell at the altar on my knees and I was sobbing and weeping. And now Armstrong put his hands on my head. And he said, I'm passing on the mantle from Smith Wigglesworth into your life, son. Get ready. God is about to use you. You would not believe what God is going to do. Fear not, for he is with you. Then Norm Armstrong lifted his hands and said, Lord, forgive me for what I thought when you told me it's Pastor Daniel. Norm Armstrong then confessed to the congregation. He said, I asked the Lord when he said, that's the man. I told him, but he's not an Aussie. And the Lord told me, he loves your country more than many of you love your country. There is no color in my kingdom. I thank the Lord for the honor and the privilege he has given me to serve Australia. There's a lot to be done, a lot of battles to be won, but we are on the winning side. Yes. few weeks later, one morning I'm praying at 4 o'clock and I get the word, in a week I want you to call my people to worship me. So I said, okay, in a week, we called special three nights of special meetings. We just got my friend's church hall. God showed up. The first night, 350 people came without any advertising within a week. I finished the meeting at 1 o'clock in the morning. Came out into the car park. I could have heard a buzzing noise. I picked up a little gadget which had like something like it looked like earphones or you know what I mean? And I didn't know what that was. And I heard a zzz, picked another one, zzz, picked another one, zzz, another one. I came and asked him, what are these? He said, people who have deafness have been healed, their hearing aids, they have thrown them. That night, 30 deaf people got healed. One lady said, my husband says, I'm in trouble now. Because you can hear everything I say. Doctors in southeastern Melbourne were giving referral letters, you know, not referral letters, rise up, catch the fire brochures to telling their patients to come to our meetings for healing. The meetings continued for 1 month, every single night, 7 p.m. to 1 a.m. for 1 year after that, 5 days a week, which resulted in us birthing a new church in that community. A lot more has to be done, but we're on the road to a great victory. Come 2010, I had gone to Israel and I took a team of 60 people to Israel. We were coming through the mountains of Tiberias when suddenly there was a commotion which broke out in the bus. My wife shouted out, Danny, come here. Because when she calls for that, I know that I'm in trouble. So I ran up the front seat to the back when I saw Diana Shield, a woman who is 72 years from Wagga Wagga, collapsed on the seat. She had flopped like that. There was a doctor sitting behind her. By this time, he had jumped and he was doing CPR. He was punching her just like crazy. And I think, why are you punching like that? I didn't know that you're supposed to do that to get the heartbeat again. He did all the procedures 4 times. He did it over and over again. He looked at me and he said, Diana is dead. Stop the bus, you need to call an ambulance. And I don't know, just the anointing came upon me and I said, no, she's not. The doctor told me later on that he thought I was off my head. He was about to overrule my authority, but for some reason he said he thought he'll shut up and move aside. I remember this to the day, looking at Diana's dead body and screaming, how dare you kill someone in Israel, Satan? Diana, come back in Jesus' name. Open your eyes and look at me. Now, in the natural, it sounds stupid to tell a dead woman to open your eyes and look at me, right? But you should have watched this body coming back to life. It was like that. The eyeballs were sunk in, they fell back in the eye. And she smiled. You should have seen the bus just erupt with cheers and claps. The Age newspaper published a whole testimony, word to word, in the newspaper. This is happening in Australia. Now, we went to Sri Lanka from there. I was at the hotel when I heard that Kevin Rudd was backstabbed by Julia Gillard. And I was really heartbroken. I didn't like Kevin Rudd because he's a deception. He's a deceiver. I'm telling you, that's the truth. I knew that he was lying, that he's a Christian. But it was proven on the SBS when he went to the footy game and someone asked him, is Jesus the Son of God? He refused to answer the question. And then he said, I go to church on Sunday. You're born in a garage does not make you a car. Going to McDonald's does not make you a Big Mac either. So I came back to Australia very heartbroken seeing what had happened because I don't like when people does injustice. You know, I thought, even though Rudd was not good, he was the elected prime minister. You can't knock him out like that. As I went into prayer, God began to speak to me, and he told me, you know, personally, I was very upset when the Victorian law was passed to permit abortion up until birth. So in Victoria, a mother could go and get an abortion a day before she delivers the baby. After the law was passed, 52 babies were born alive when they did the partial birth abortion. 52 babies came out alive. 26 were put in a bucket of formalin and killed. 26 were locked up in a room. They cried on a table until they died. This is the official Hansard report of the medical profession of Victoria. And I was very heartbroken about that. And the words were, do you want to see abortion made history in Australia? You got to understand this. Australia's population is decreasing. The Western birth rate is 1.7. To sustain a civilization, you need 2.11. The Muslim birth rate is 4.1. In France, it's 8.2. It does not take a rocket scientist to find out how fast they're going to overpopulate us if you don't wake up. So when you have an abortion, that's a potential Aussie being killed. I understand people have various circumstances, but the fact is we are actually aborting our children while they don't have abortion. Muslims don't have abortion. They have more than one wife and they keep breeding, have a lot of children. Gay marriage can't produce children. So we are, in other words, we are making people ineffective in producing another generation. While our generation is getting older and older, there's a massive gap created in the country. If you're not smart and think smart and speak out the truth with love, we will lose our nation very fast, faster than what we can think of. So France is in big trouble right now because there is something like 12 to 15% Muslims already, and they believe in 20 years it will be an Islamic country. Large parts of Europe will fall to Islam in the next 20, 30 years. Australia, there's still hope. So that night, Jesus in a dream again spoke to me, and I'm sharing this because you need to hear my heart, because you're people who are of church. I'm talking to Christians, and also some of you might not be church, but you'll have some Christian background. I want you to understand my heart. This, to win Australia, we have to work in the natural, but also we need to work on the supernatural. If you don't bring the God factor into place, we will not be able to retain and sustain and support and hold on to this country. Because this country is built on Judeo-Christian values. That's why it's such a blessed nation. Islam is absolutely spiritual, absolutely demonic. The only way you can fight that power is through prayer. You know why we are not winning the war with terrorism? Because the church is not praying enough. Have you heard of the warlord called Konye in Uganda? I was speaking to people who were Konye's soldiers. And I was speaking to Pastor Melindi from Uganda. Now, you know what happened? Whenever the troops would go to capture him, people who work very closely with Konye, his right-hand men, said this, they are now born-again believers. Konye will summon spirits which will tell him, they're coming from this direction, go on that direction, you will be safe. They couldn't arrest him. They couldn't capture him. He evaded arrest. The church one day decided, we need to do something about this. And they mobilized prayer and they went into the jungle and started interceding and repenting and praying. As they started praying, Konye's army, part by part, the army of the Ugandan government captured them and killed them or arrested them. And they confessed, Konye confessed, I cannot get those spirits to function anymore. I'll tell you an interesting story. I was in an aircraft, which I do all the time. I normally get the aisle seat so that I have a captive audience. You know? And there was a husband and wife sitting next to me. We started talking. I asked them where they were going to. They said they are just returning from a holiday. I said, oh, great, knowing they're going to ask me where I was going to. I said, I'm a political party leader and I'm going to speak at a campaign meeting. And we're talking, and when they heard that, I gave her the brochure. She looked at it and she first must have thought that I'm a Muslim. But when she realized who I was, she was absolutely excited. So was the husband. Then she told me, wow, everything I think in my heart, think in my mind, I want to say it, but I'm too scared because of possibly being called a racist. You are saying it all in your brochure. Then the Lord gave me a word for her. I said, excuse me, madam, is it right that you're going through this problem? She looked at me and she said, what? Are you a psychic? I said, no, I'm a Christian. I'm a pastor. She said, you know, everything you just said is what I'm going through. I went to my psychic, who I've been going to for years. She normally helps me. But the last time I went to her, she said this. She did something for a while, then she walked into the room, came out from the room with a statue of Jesus. And she gave me the statue of Jesus and she said, I'm sorry, I can't help you again. You'll have to ask him to help you. And she said, I was surprised. She said, then 2 days later, I had a dream. I was walking on the beach. Jesus was coming from the other direction. And he was motioning me like that. Come unto me. I told her what it was. I said, firstly, psychic is losing powers. They cannot channel mediums because the prayers of the saints are breaking over the darkness, bringing the light into heaven, into Australia. Secondly, I said, the hand gesture of Jesus was for you to come into him, to give your heart to him. The next thing is, husband and wife are weeping in the plane, holding their hands. I led them to the Lord. In the last 3 years after starting the political party, I've led more people to Jesus than my 15 years prior in ministry in Australia. So Australia, there's a great destiny for our nation. We are responsible to seeing that fulfilled. Europe is going the wrong way. US is going the wrong way with President Obama. Australia is the hope for the nations right now. The decisions we make today is going to determine the destiny of our nation. Smith Wigglesworth's prophetic word from 100 years ago approximately was, by the way, Norm Armstrong went to be with the Lord 2 years after he prophesied over me. Approximately 100 years ago, he said, the generation which lives through into the 21st century will be the generation which will see Jesus come. That's you and me. Come on, let's give Jesus a clap, eh? So there's a lot of work to be done. Aussies need Jesus. But do we really love our fellow Aussie? When did you last cry for someone you know? When did you last ask God, save my neighbor? Before we could do anything else, let's get a heart for the lost people. Because life is too short. The decisions we make now is going to determine our destiny, heaven or hell. I want to see every Aussie come to Jesus. So at the Rise Up Australia prayer meetings, we pray only for Australia. 1 hour to 1.5 hours or 2 hours, we absolutely focus on Australia. We pray for government leaders, politicians, expose the evil agenda of Islam. You know, we have every Wednesday, my main team of 50 of my intercessors, 40 to 50 of my intercessors, we come together and pray for Australia for 3.5 hours every Wednesday morning. My office stops work. Phones are switched off from 9 or 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. We don't answer calls. My whole office staff, all are at prayer. God has exposed so many terrorist attacks which were going to take place in Australia through that prayer time. Amazing. And I can go on telling you story after story after story, but I want you to know prayer is powerful. Prayer is powerful. I'm going to close with this one very interesting testimony. Is that all right? Yeah? Okay. Some of you say very often, I know people tell me, Pastor Daniel, I have a full-time job. I'm a part-time worker. I want to tell you, you're a full-time worker with a part-time job. With Jesus, you don't switch on and switch off. With Jesus, you're switched on. Wherever you are, wherever you're working, you are an ambassador for Jesus to where you are. I used to work as a sales manager for a company in Sri Lanka. My staff were all Buddhist. Once I drove to my factory to get something done, when I was approached by one of the staff members saying there was a girl who operated one of my machines, she was sick, and whether I can take her to hospital because everyone does not have cars there. So I said, yeah, sure. Second message, can you come quickly because she's very sick? So I threw my car keys. I said, put her in the car, I'll be there. Third message, come right now, she's serious. Now I got really worried. Then I ran out. They were carrying the 22-year-old girl whose name is Vasanti. I looked at her. She was dead. They believed she was not. I knew she was dead. She was like that. Her eyes were wide open. Her black portion of the eye sunk in. And I said, get into the car quickly. So I opened they opened the back door. I jumped in the driver's seat to drive the car to the hospital. I said, close the back door. They said, we can't close the back door. I said, why? The legs are not bending. So now a head has come to the other end of the door, the back seat. The legs are sticking out. I jumped out of the car and I got a great idea. Put the window down, lifted the legs up, closed the door. I had to take her somehow. You can do that in Sri Lanka. You know, it's all right. So two ladies in the back seat with the dead body, they think that she's not dead. They think still she's got this epileptic fit. One guy got in the car, turned my car, and I was with my hazards on, driving over the nature strip, over the islands. I just wanted to get rid of this girl because I was too scared, thinking I'll be able to go to court for carrying a dead body. While driving, the supervisor who got into the car says to me, sir, we need to take the girl to see her mother. And I'm saying, duh, how can she see the mother? Can't you see? I didn't want to say she's dead. I said, can't you see? And the guy goes, you don't understand Buddhist culture. Last wish has to be granted. Take her to see the mother. I said, if I'm going to take her to the house, I'm not taking her to the hospital. I'll drop her at the house and you take care of that. He says, okay, that's all right. Take her to the house. We parked the car at the house. They dragged the body out of the car. All the villagers came running, 60 Buddhist people were there. They carried the dead body, which they thought was not dead, into the house, put it on the bed. I was supposed to leave, but I could not leave. I went into the room where the dead body was lying. And I just stayed quietly with tears streaming down my cheek while they are trying to do things to try to wake her up. The doctor came in front of my own eyes, pronounced her dead. Now, as he pronounced it, the whole place just mourning and wailing with sadness. Oh, they were crying, they were hitting their chest and their forehead and really mourning, wailing. Because this young girl, 22, I'm standing there very quietly, tears streaming down my cheek, really moved with sadness because I knew this girl. She's a lovely young woman working for me. And I heard the Holy Spirit tell me, do you know why you are here? You know what I told the Holy Spirit? I really don't want to know. And then I told him, before he could tell me anything else, I said, if you are trying to tell me to go and pray for this girl, sorry. I don't mind praying for a dead person in the morgue when no one is watching. If they don't wake up, no problem. If they wake up, I'll tell everyone. But I am not going to do this in front of 60 Buddhist people, because if she does not wake up, I'll be stoned because I interrupted their mourning. The Holy Spirit, after I finish yapping so much, says, do you believe I can raise her? Yeah, I know you can raise her, but not me. I know that. The Lord tells me, you can't, I can. Be obedient, do it. I'll try this out, I thought. And I walked. My knees were banging each other like a drum. I remember wobbling myself to the foot of the bed. And I'm looking at this dead body. It's turned like purple. They're saying, in Sri Lankan, they're saying that the hands are cold. She had long hair. Eyeballs are wide open, eyes wide open, and the eyeballs had sunk in. 1 hour and 40 minutes had gone by this time. The undertakers were coming to collect the body. And the Holy Spirit says, pray. So I think emotion, fear, faith, everything mixed came out this loud cry out of my mouth, something like this. In the name of Jesus, spirit of death, leave this body. Vasanti, come back. As I shouted, the 60 people who are crying. As they turned towards me, something very weird happened. Never seen this before. The dead girl did this. She screamed, made a screechy noise, and her hair, like someone held a table fan. The people who were mourning jumped off the bed. They freaked out. But when that happened, I got very encouraged because I knew I'll win. So now I stood there and I said, I know she'll come back to life. But the demons which have killed her will come into you. And I thought they'll all say, I want Jesus. As I said, they'll come into you. There was long jump, high jump, running jumps. The 60 Buddhists just went out of the windows, out of the doors. They jumped through the windows. They ran out of the doors. They just disappeared. They got so scared because they saw the face of the girl. It was so demonic. I mean, it was horrible. Someone is touching my leg. I turned around and looked. The mother on her knees. Sir, I don't know who your God is. Can I ask him to help me? I led the mother to the Lord. And the next few minutes was very encouraging and exciting. I battled with the spirit. And I said, in Jesus' name, come out. And the demon will respond. After 3 minutes, I said, that's it. Up now in Jesus' name. And the girl, she came out and she sat. And she looked. And she looked at the mother and she said, what is he doing in my house? She didn't know anything. Then I heard clapping. I looked through the window. The people who ran were all watching. They could have seen the girl sit up on the bed. Good opportunity now. So I walked up to the front door. As I walked up to the front door, about 10 of them started climbing trees. It was not funny, I'll tell you what. I thought, in the Bible it says, when the demons were cast out, they went into the pigs and the pigs went into the water and died. I thought these guys were going to jump from the trees because the demons had got into them. But that was not the case. They were actually breaking white flowers. They thought I was a messenger from Buddha. They were breaking white flowers because that's what they take to the Buddhist temple to offer to Buddha. So now they broke the flowers, gave it to everyone. 60 of them are coming towards me like this. I said, hold it! Don't drop any flowers. Don't bow down. Stand where you are. I could have told them to stand on the head. They would have done it. They were so scared. And the village headman said, listen to what he says. I said, I'm not a messenger from Buddha. I'm a child of God. Jesus sent me here. Jesus brought Vasanti back to life. You need Jesus. It was one of the beautiful days. 60 Buddhist people fell on the gravel soil, gave their hearts to the Lord. One of the most funniest things, the greatest comedy in the 21st century, is the fact that a black fellow from Sri Lanka has started a political party in Australia. It is not possible. In the natural, it is not possible. Leave alone standing for a party to lead a party. and to see the support the Australian nation is giving me right now. It's supernatural. So why I'm sharing this is to take Australia. It's not going to be just natural. It has to be supernatural. So we need to work with the nation. Church has given a bad taste to the nation. Church has not stood up for the nation. Church has failed the nation. How many churches will let me come and preach today? They're too scared to bring me in. I honor this man of God and this woman of God. Give them a clap. Today when I was sitting here, the Lord showed me something, and I'll tell you this. The Lord told me that your church and the two of you are going to be the doorway for God to move in Queensland through our vision to come into fulfillment. I don't know what that means long term, but that you're going to be the doorway to open for me and the ministry and the vision to take Australia to spread into Queensland, because your heart is for the agenda of the Lord and not anything else. Praise God. Yes. So I just want to say I love Australia with all my heart. I told my wife the other day, I said, I'll stand fighting and die standing. I'll not live on my knees for the rest of my life. I want my grandchildren one day to look at me and say, Papa, you're a hero, not a wimp. We have a responsibility for our children and grandchildren to protect Australia and keep her Australian for generations to come. God bless you. Thank you.